that literally moves the Earth out of its orbit. Now, a nuclear attack probably wouldn't do that by itself, so the timing has to be right for other things to have to be occurring at that point in time.
Well, that would be the idea of those attacks and those vibrations that are being put into the Earth that are going to cause this, make it easier to start this shift. In fact, the shift has already started. The North Pole, or true north, has moved, I don't know how many hundreds of feet since the 30s.
Well, when I was a pilot, I flew out of Minneapolis-St. Paul for a number of years. They had 29 left and 29 right, which is now 30 left and 30 right.
You got it. And as a matter of fact, they made a similar change about a year ago in Portland, and everybody sat around scratching their heads about how it could be. Well, that's how far it moved.
Yes. This is real.
No, this is real. Yes, you bet it is.
Well, another thing that happens with this is, as for instance, we go to the south, we move closer to the equator. You have the equatorial bulge.
Yes.
Like riding on the rides at the fairgrounds, you know, and if you're on the outside, you really get flung around.
Mm-hmm.
Well, as we move south, the crust doesn't tend to bow out as much as the water does. And that's why all the maps that show the United States being inundated with water, because we're going further south and this water is being drawn up higher than it normally is. And of course, the parts that are at the equator that move further south toward the South Pole, those will actually rise up out of the ground more.
Well, there
is also where you get the sinking of Atlantis and the rising of Atlantis kind of thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. There is a very interesting statement made in the book of Revelation, paraphrasing it, that four angels control the winds of the four corners of the earth. And from satellite technology, they have proven that there literally are four corners to the earth. And because of the prevailing winds, the seas pile up in certain places, and they're slightly lower in other places.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these angels stop the wind from blowing. Now, just imagine what would happen without even a polar shift as the water seeks to equalize itself. Think of the tsunamis that would create.
And think of it as if we do have the shifting crust, you talk about those very high winds again, how much that's even going to aggravate it from being normal.
The human mind could not comprehend the destruction. No way. I just don't think you could fathom it.
Well, Michael Gordon Scallion talks about what, the level 12 earthquake kind of things?
Yes.
I mean, oh, yes.
You know... The destruction from a nuclear attack, which I think biblically will happen, I think that's one of the four winds, and I think their shifting crust is the last one.
Yeah, people say, of course, a level 12 Richter could never occur, but they also said an F-6 couldn't happen either.
Yes. There's going to be a realignment of thinking among the scientific community.
Well, you know how slow the scientists are to change their theories once they're locked into something.
Well, yes, you can't blame them personally. They're raised in it.
Right.
And it's a tradition. It's a traditional system. You do have your renegades, and thank God for the renegades, because they're the pioneers who probably have more truth about what's going on. You do have the scientists that believe in cataclysm, you know.
Well, there's been, I can't pinpoint it, but there's been some studies that I had read about that talked about, you know, the rapid evolution thing, that a lot of that takes place when these cataclysmic things happen.
That's
all
correct.
Of a sudden, there is sort of big leaps in.
Mm-hmm.
No, it makes all sense in the world.
Oh, absolutely.
Because they really have to adapt to a new environment.
That's right.
But that's probably better termed as adaptation, when the species are built to adapt.
Well, I personally believe that evolution is true. I believe creation is true also. I don't think they're contradictory. They just didn't happen in 6 days. Those 6 days were however millions, billions of years.
Days as we understand them.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I agree with you, caller. Thank you.
Thank you.
Take care. I've always thought the two could go hand in hand. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Stuart Best and not a lot of time.
Yeah. Since the term is earth science, one caller mentioned, Mr. That sense he had on, let's look at the oceans as a lens that might be heating the earth. And this is kind of an interesting concept. I'd like to be finding somebody that might. This is my own personal theory, that, the ocean could work as a lens to heat the core of the earth. Now, somebody might say, well, the oceans are cold inside there. But a lens stays cold, but yet it can light a cigarette if you light it. Now, I'm a little into astrogeology and volcanology and all that, and why there is a ring of fire. And this subject becomes rather interesting. The Michio Kaku, he might. I'd like to get some earth scientist interested in this theory of mine. What do you think about that, Art? And I'd like to know what your guest thinks about it too, because I think it's could be, kind of profound. So there might be mountains in there. You might have scratches of land, but you still light a cigarette. The focal end is still in the center of the earth. And as the sun reacts on this, of course, the earth is going to heat.
Well, you're talking about the theory of global warming, sir, is what you're talking about. The lens effect produced by additional things in our atmosphere. That's what you're talking about. I don't think it's just your theory. It's a lot of people's theory. Listen, we are running out of time, Stuart. I want you to be able to... We have a link to your website on our website now. I should have had that up much earlier. I should have asked you. Everybody has a website. I just forgot to ask. the phone number where... And what you think... people who have not been exposed to Stuart Best before and who want to be, what should they get first?
Well... Boy, that's a hard question. It depends on their area of interest. We have so many different things. We have political videos. We have Enigma videos like the UFOs, the Atlantis Chronicles.
Most of my audience is going to be more interested in that, I assure you, than they will be the political stuff.
Yeah, probably our UFO video and the Atlantis Chronicles. We are coming out in June with another one. Be about June 10th, I figure, to have it off. It's called Mega Earth Changes in the Coming Polar Shift.
Wow.
And that'll be, as far as we know, a two-hour documentary.
Excellent. Well, you really have been an excellent guest.
Well, thank you.
Excellent. And I'm glad we had you on the air, and good luck answering all your email.
Well, thank you.
All right, take care, my friend.
Yep.
That's it. Now you can get a little sleep. That was Stuart Best, folks. Now, tonight... Technically, tonight on the program, we're going to be talking about time travel. Dr. Bruce Goldberg is going to be here, and he once did a dreamland with me on the subject of time travel that was absolutely superb, elegant. And I expect that from him tomorrow night, so, it's one of my favorite topics of all time. That wasn't even an attempt at a pun, I guarantee you. Dr. Bruce Goldberg, tomorrow night on time travel. And then Thursday night, Friday morning, Kevin Ryerson is going to be here. Friday night, Saturday, a good friend of mine, Peter Weisbeck, is going to be subbing for me. So that's kind of a outline of the week that comes ahead. I'm Art Bell from the High Desert. Night all.
Take you back to the night of May 18th, 1999, on Art Bell, Somewhere in Time.
All right, Stuart Best, you're back on. So are you, caller?
Hi.
Hi.
Okay, where I was coming from, Art, you can define the classifications. There won't be time for that. With Michio Kaku, obviously, it's pretty straightforward, very simple. But what we have in between... is the elements within civilization that account for people's evolutionary changes within the levels, i.e., where is the zeros, where are the ones, where are the twos? Well, as I began to look at the planet, and I have to really thank Crazy Richard, and by the way, my nickname's Crazy Paul, so I can relate. The fact that what we have to do is, and by the way, guys, I'm prophesized out. I mean, we can debate this until the next millennium, but I'll tell you what, if I'll be here, I'll be here. If I won't, I won't. It's that simple. But
we probably will be debating this until the next millennium.
Thank you. So anyway, what I'd like to see is a more generalized model. And where I'm going to is, living in Phoenix now some years, I personally have noticed a sort of spiritual uplifting from me. And with that in mind, I began to look at Michio Kaku's classification and reflect upon myself. And with that process, and of course with your coaching, Art, I found myself locking onto a type 1 more and more, i.e. planetary handling. And I had some Phoenix missile experience to help justify that in terms of a worldwide handle, shall we say.
Do you understand what this caller is talking about when he's talking about classifications of civilizations? Have you heard Michio Kaku?
No.
Okay.
I could define it if you want.
All right, let me hear you do it quickly.
Zero, type zero, basically means that 90% of all the civilizations that ever begin fail. But what he doesn't clearly say is that failure can be, shall we say, parochial on a planet, i.e., perhaps 90% of the planet gets wiped out. So that accounts for somewhat of the prophecies in saying that there's certain Earth changes that will only, shall we say, wipe out certain areas of the planet. So what you have is a type zero that can't get past element 92 on the periodic table, i.e., uranium. But within that uranium level, we also can have a positive attitude, perhaps a type 1 usage of uranium. So we can kind of look at that later. But what we then do is that the type 0s fail, nuclear winter, etc. Mm-hmm. Then we get to a type 1. As we ease into a type 1, we're going to lose the type 0s, perhaps or not. And as the planet gets more of a control of a type 1, i.e., we can now control things that the guys are throwing the missiles around. Okay, we have a nuclear winter control, fine. We can stop comets, perhaps, for hitting. Maybe we got one coming June 30th. That's fine. But where I like to make my inroads as an engineer is, what's the worst-case scenario? Well, the worst-case scenario takes a little bit of spookiness because this involves somewhat of a sun vision. In other words, the type 1 has control of the planet. Okay, we are ecological, we're balanced. Mm-hmm. But then what happens when, shall we say, a supernova happens from our sun, whether it be the internal sun or the external sun, shall we say? Mm-hmm. Well, then we have perhaps the need for a type 2 blessings or insight. Well, to get from a type 1 to a type 2, you're probably looking at an incredible spiritual paradigm shift coupled with the facts of the facts, i.e., what are these northern lights all about? What is the really heating of the planet? What is the center core that we say is molten? Well, there's a whole bunch of things that say it's not molten, but we won't go there too much because you can't touch it. But from where I'm coming from, I believe we have a planetary assignment here that clearly is a type 1 vision with a type 2 need for insight. And that's where we come into beyond the scriptures, beyond the rhetoric, beyond the prophecy. Because these type 2s are here. You want to call it the collective unconscious. Ed Dames calls it a great mind, etc.
All right. You're covering a lot of territory. Let's stop right there. So suffice to say that a theoretical physicist that I have on, named Michio Kaku, doctor, says there are these various levels of civilization. The caller ended up by saying the type 2s are here. Meaning that there are, and after all, it'd be fun to address this with you. I know you have fairly fundamentalist views, but when you look into the sky, there are, out here in the desert, more stars than you could even count a tiny portion of that you can even see.
Yes.
Around them are planets, many of them, no doubt, habitable, possibly harboring life, probably harboring life. And some of them, at least, have progressed past the point of Earth, far past the point of Earth.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it not reasonable to conclude that there is other life out there and that it is here visiting?
Well, I don't think you can draw from the scriptures that that's not possible. The Lord makes a comment that's very interesting. He says, I will bathe my sword in the heavens with blood and with the kings of the earth. Now, who is it in the heavens that he is angry at?
Well, then there was something about many, many houses.
Yes.
and other sheep have I, which of that I must go to. It's interesting that the Hopis, for example, talk about the way is difficult and it's like a sharp knife, and that they must stay on the edge of this sharp knife and not fall off it.
Right.
Well, Jesus made the comment that straight is the gate and narrow is the way. So that leaves one to wonder, doesn't it? Exactly who are these other folds that he was talking to?
Yeah, one is always left to wonder. First time caller line, you're on the air with Stuart Best. Hi.
It's my turn now.
Your turn now, yes. Where are you?
Okay, I'm in Murray, Kentucky.
Murray, Kentucky. Well, you're sure going to have to yell at us because you're not loud.
Okay. I just had a couple of questions to ask. You keep referring to the writings of Enoch.
Yes.
Is that a book that you can buy in any Christian bookstore?
No, they're very difficult to find, actually, and I don't have a copy of it in front of me, or I'd tell you where you could buy it. If you would write us, we can give you that address.
Okay, well, can I get it at the 800 number that you...
Yes, yeah, just call us at the 800 number and we can...
Is this the Enoch that was caught up in the whirlwind?
Yes, that's what it purports to be.
Okay.
It's very interesting book. It's extra biblical, but it's interesting that the Bible does quote from it.
Huh. Okay.
Which gives it a little more veracity, I think.
You also said earlier that in the Bible that it specifically targeted the United States for being destroyed.
Yes.
Can you tell me where you got that?
Well, you'll find that in Isaiah chapter 47, Jeremiah chapter 50, 51, Revelation chapter 17, and Revelation 18. The code word is Babylon.
Is that clear enough? Caller?
Yeah.
All right, well then, happy perusing. Listen... You know, I just put something up on my website that I want to talk to you about.
Yeah.
It's not the first one, but this involves a fireman fighting a fire and the image of a ghost. Now, that's something I've dealt with on my program a lot.
Mm-hmm.
A whole lot, as a matter of fact, Stuart. And I guess I would ask you, with your perspective, what you think a ghost is. What is a ghost?
I'm not sure what a ghost is, but I do know that the Lord did say that ghosts exist, because he asked Doubting Thomas to feel his wounds and everything and said, "See, I'm not a ghost," which is indicative or implying that ghosts exist.
Okay. Interesting answer. Wildcard line, you're on the air with Stuart Best. Hi.
Hi, Art. This is John, Bozeman, Montana.
Hello, John.
They're shifting crust. Hapgood talked about that in the mid-50s, and Einstein said pretty good theory.
Yes.
Basically, what happens is the Earth is balanced and spinning, but the snow builds up in higher elevations at the poles and on the mountaintops, and it starts putting a torque on the surface of the Earth. And the Earth has got, a skin like a mile deep of hard stuff, and then it's on a molten... center of some kind. So as this surface starts to shift to balance itself, at some point it starts heating up that molten lava, which then makes it slipperier, which then lets it slide faster, which makes it hotter and all that. Hapgood says that basically we in North America would go south about 4,000 miles in a period of about 4 days.
Mm-hmm.
And that this is actually the shifting of the poles that's talking about, or the shifting of the Earth's crust, and explains why the woolly mammoths moved up at some point into that frozen area in a very short period of time like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting. There are several theories, and of course you've got this Tesla scalar wave operations going on that are being thought of as possibly melting the poles and shifting the weights. But Scripture indicates that it is the nuclear...
You like an angel. Walk like an angel. Talk like an angel. But I got wise. You're the devil in disguise. Oh, yes, you are. Devil in disguise. You fool me with your kisses. You cheated and you schemed. Heaven knows how you lied to me. You're not the way you seem. You look like an angel. Walk like an angel. Talk like an angel. But I got wise. You're the devil in disguise. Oh, yes, you are. Devil in disguise. I thought that I was in heaven, but I was sure surprised. Heaven help me, I didn't see the devil in your eyes. Look like an angel.
Walk like an angel.
Walk like an angel. Talk like an angel.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
Morning, everybody. Stuart Best is my guest, and we're going to lay more heavily into the phones this hour. Or whatever you want to call them, but they're not right 100% of the time. Then what are they? They're something more than...
Well, according to what I can find out, you can tap into the, well, how do I want to say, spiritual.
Yes.
And there are many people who are given visions, and the accuracy of the vision determines where the vision actually came from. If God claims in the scriptures that if he gives a word of prophecy and it not come to pass, that the person spoke of their own volition. But if it does come to pass, he gave it to them. Now, we have many people in the United States and around the world who are, for example, being shown visions of the time of the end. In fact, we're being inundated here with those kind of reports. That 1999 and the year 2000 are, yes, going to be horrendous times, especially for the United States and the people of America.
Yeah, I definitely don't disagree with that. I'm inundated by people who are having these visions. Believe me, I am. So that doesn't surprise you. In other words, that many people are suddenly reporting these recurring visions or dreams of...
Oh, no. In fact, I've had several myself. In one vision, I was taken to Washington, D.C. It was a dream vision, but a dream vision is different than a dream. A dream is more nebulous, and you're apt to forget it. A dream vision is imprinted upon your memory like a real, literal event.
Mm-hmm.
And in this particular vision dream, I was on my bed asleep, like Daniel said on his visions. I was taken to Washington, D.C., and I was taken into the halls of Congress where all the deals are made, and they're walking around with their suitcases and suits, and the Lord said, it's over. It does not matter what they do, it's over.
It's over.
In other words, there is, how do I say, the ancient church taught that from Adam and Eve to the end would be 6,000 years. At which point, God simply terminates this age in preparation for what is called the millennial age. I'm sure you've heard of that.
Of course.
Because a lot of the other prophecies talk about the thousand-year reign. And the emphatic, I cannot tell you how strong this impression was that it was over. And done. It was almost like ancient Babylon. You have been found weighed in the balances, and you have been found wanting.
Mm-hmm.
That America, through its congressmen and through its legislatures and the executive department and the Supreme Court and their decisions, have irritated the Lord to the point where he is going to act.
Well, I understand his point of view, actually. First time caller line, you're on the air with Stuart Best. Hi.
Hello?
Hello.
Oh, hi. Yes, I have actually two questions.
Okay.
I'm calling from Lake Geneva, Wisconsin.
All right.
Number one, for your guest, I need to know, you keep referring to the scriptures, and I need to know, do you have any actual scripture to back all the stuff that
you're saying? Yes, he does, but I asked him not to quote that. I asked him to, and I do that with everybody on my program, ma'am. I don't mind discussion of religion or the Bible, but we don't sit here and quote scriptures like Sunday school, church.
Right, but me as a believer also, you know, he has been saying some things as disillusion. What is that? I must have missed that. Something with God and disillusion.
Well, no, what it is the Lord says in the Thessalonians that he will send down a strong delusion upon the earth to literally fool all those people that refused his word and refused his son. And part of that delusion, we are convinced, is the alien UFO evolution concept versus their creation concept. Most people, the Bible says emphatically that the world towards the end rejects virtually the entire Bible and its message. Well, we have seen that happening in the United States and around the world. Mm-hmm. And it is because of this rejection that he does this. That's very, very harsh, and it's very hard to understand, I guess, for it is even for me. But that's what it says.
All right.
Okay. One more thing. You had made reference to something in Genesis about... it was after the flood about giants?
No, that
was prior to the flood, actually.
They were before the flood, and it says after that, which I think refers to after the flood. In fact, if you go into the scriptural runs of Israel, they came up against a race of giants. And where did those giants come from? Well, I believe they were part of the Nephilim.
They'd still be here if Noah had enough room in the ark.
Yeah.
All right, ma'am. Thank you. Wild card line, you're on the air with Stuart Best. Hi.
Hi. That last caller wants to know about the Giants. It's in Genesis 6, so she could just read that.
All right.
That'll clear. Anyway, a quick thing about the earthquakes and something about Jerusalem, if I may. I was poking around today, and I was reading some wire stories, and I went back to May 7th of, obviously, of this month. In the last 11 days, I came up with, just out of news stories, I came up with 15 quakes of 6 or over. Now, when I went to a site that was a geological site and had the whole month, had all the earthquakes listed for the whole month,
right.
I counted 25 of 6 or better in the last 11 days with 2 sevens.
I know. And if you really want something that'll freak you out,
unbelievable.
Go take a look at what's occurring at Mammoth.
Oh, yeah, well, see, that's because I live in California. That's what kind of got me started on it.
Something's about to be born at Mammoth.
Yeah, you got that right.
Earthquakes are not tectonic movement. Those earthquakes, that's lava moving around under there, brother.
Yeah, it's up high.
Yeah.
For your guest, is he familiar with the Temple Mount Faithful?
Yes.
Oh, have you received their email today about the Holy Rock, which is the Rock of Abraham and Isaac? And it was also reported in Haaretz, the newspaper in Jerusalem.
No, I haven't.
Okay, what they're stating is that what Haaretz was alluding to is that they've had reports of the rock starting to... water was coming from the rock to make it...
Oh, yes, I have heard that.
Well, I haven't. What are you guys talking about?
Okay, well, in one of the prophecies in Ezekiel, what will happen in the millennium is that a stream will flow from... the Holy Rock, where Abraham, where Abraham sacrificed Isaac, and this stream will come, it'll purify the waters, and it'll be a healing. Whoever, you know, enters into this stream, it will become a you know, a blessing and a healing for them. So, but what's happening now is now they're noticing that this rock is water is actually coming from this rock, and they sent out this email
really?
To who's ever on their list today saying, yes, they've confirmed it. Now, it's not the gushing stream of Ezekiel, but it's the beginning, they believe, of the fulfillment of that prophecy. Maybe your guest could go into that more.
Well, earlier in the program, much earlier in the program, I said I had been taking a youth elixir.
Yeah, but this, no, this isn't scotch, though. No.
Goodbye. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi, with Stuart Best, Art Bell, and whoever else might be around.
Good morning, Art.
Morning, where are you?
Well, I'm in the north end of Tornado Alley, actually.
North end of Tornado Alley.
Northeast Oklahoma, listening to you on KWON, 1400 AM.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Well, so there is no doubt that things are happening. My question is, what do you attribute the Earth's magnetic field to? I mean, whenever we see magnetism, there's always an electric current to go with it. And one theory that I've looked into is basically an electric current around the iron core.
Yes, that's
sure.
Of the Earth.
Exactly. It's its own dynamo.
Now, it would, of course, be getting some energy from someplace. I would say it's a giant induction motor, having worked with them in the past, getting its the inductive current or the magnetic flux from the sun. If the Earth's field flips, that would be indicative of a flippage or a turning in the sun's current.
True, but you also have to remember that the sun undergoes polar shifts as well. In fact, it's undergoing one probably right now.
So I would say that our polar shift is corresponding with the sun's polar shift.
In this particular instance, it appears that cycle 23 may exactly do that. But we can't be certain.
Well, I can say that if we do have Dr. Doom has said, a kill shot from the sun, we are in serious trouble.
And absolutely.
That's mainly due to the damage of the ozone layer, and this is not through the use of fluorocarbons.
Well, that's true, too, but that's another story altogether.
Yes.
All right, sir. Thank you very much for the call. Listen, let me read this email. Water flowing from the rock, a sign of redemption. One of the most exciting events over the last few days has been the news of the water flowing from the holy rock of Abraham and Isaac on the Temple Mount, which was in the midst of the first and second temples. According to what we now know, the water is definitely flowing from under the rock. The Arabs on the Temple Mount deny this and have tried to stop the flow by many means and just have not succeeded. What we now know is that they're trying to bring in special pumps to stop the flow. In any case, the water continues to flow. Nothing can stop it. The special news has caused a lot of excitement in Israel. Since the destruction of the Second Temple, the Jewish people have been in anticipation of this event with great desire and prayers, because we always knew this would be one of the signs of the last days and the redemption of Israel and the Third Temple. I'll be son of a gun if that isn't what I've got in email here.
Yeah, we had heard that. That's been around for about a week. We hadn't put it out on our global reports because we weren't able to confirm it. We'll have to check that out and see if that's actually true. If it is true, that is a fulfillment or a partial or a beginning fulfillment
right.
of a river that's actually going to flow from there.
Boy, that would be something. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, it's Paul from Tempe, Arizona. How you doing?
I'm just fine, Paul.
Well, I'm just an old Boy Scout working on a shaman merit badge, but what we're looking at here, I believe, according to Michio Kaku, is a civilization shift. And what's occurring, though, what hasn't been expressed by previous guests on your show, Art, is what we really have here on the planet. What we have, in my opinion, and I've modeled it somewhat recently, is sort of a classification scheme, but really with an infinite number of in-between levels.
Listen, this sounds like we need to go somewhere. Can you hold on through
sure.
a break?
Absolutely.
All right, we've got to take a break. We'll be right back.
It's been a too long time with no peace of mind, and I'm ready for the times to get better.
Change is coming. Can you feel it? That's the only sure thing. Change. Well, death and taxes.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
Hoping to find a way out. I've had enough of this continual rain. Changes are coming, no doubt. It's been a too long time with no peace of mind. And I'm ready for the times to get better. You seem to want from me what I cannot give. I feel so lonesome at times. I have a dream.
Here's some exciting news for Coast to Coast fans. If you've already been a StreamLink member, you know what a super value our subscriber service is. For around 15 cents a day, you get such great features as podcasts, that's automatic downloads, Coast to Coast shows directly onto your computer, desktop, or MP3 player. And by now, we've greatly expanded our full show library, so you have access to multi-year downloads. Imagine having hundreds of your favorite Coast to Coast shows at your fingertips to listen to, collect, and take on the go with you. You'll also get access to a whole library of Art Bell classics, Somewhere in Time shows, available as stream broadcasts, plus our fun live chat sessions, and we hold those twice a month. There's never been a better time to join StreamLink. You can visit coasttocoastam.com today to sign up on our secure servers. That's StreamLink. Simply visit coasttocoastam.com. This month in the After Dark magazine, read all about the magical powers of the human body, including psychometry, where everyday objects offer portals to other dimensions of information, or orgone energy. Maybe you shook hands with somebody and felt a surge of information about that person. It's all in the March issue of After Dark. Subscribe now by calling toll-free the new number, 1-888-261-6392. That's 1-888-261-6392. 1-888-261-6392.
Now, we take you back to the night of May 18th, 1999, on Art Bell, Somewhere in Time.
Back now to Stuart Best, and what we're talking about tonight, this morning is big, really big, too. Stuart, there was a beginning of time.
Yes.
I believe this, whether you want to talk to the scientists who talk about the Big Bang and all that, or you want to talk to people like yourself who no doubt believe in creation as described in the Bible. Mm-hmm. There was a beginning of everything, of what we are, who we are, what's here, and time.
Yes.
Could there be an end to time, Stuart?
Oh, definitely. Eternity in the scripture is not endless time, it's the absence of time. It's a whole new dimension.
The absence of time.
Yes. You're transported out of time-space into an eternal future, which is without time. In fact, it's very interesting if you read some of the near-death experiences where they've gone to heaven or claim they have gone to heaven, that they claim that the music, for example, has no beat to it because there's no time. It's very, very strange. Our concepts of time, of course, are probably not entirely accurate.
You want to expand on that a little bit? Not entirely. In what sense?
Well, this is hard to explain, but the way I look at it, let's say you have a wagon wheel, and the rim is time, and in the center is the hub, which is eternity. Now, the Lord makes a comment that whom he foreknew, he predestinated to go back to be with him. The only way you can understand that is that by being in eternity, he can transverse time. He sees all of it from the beginning of it to the end. The comments made in the Old Testament that I stretched out the heavens as a tent, and I put in all of the hosts of heaven, the stars, etc., etc., that implies at the beginning of time and space. Now, time, we assume, is an energy force of some type. That we have a past, we have a present, and we have a future. Now, biblical prophecy, a lot of people think, for example, that prophecy is prediction. But the scriptures would say that it's not. It's actual fact. And what the Lord does is he views all the decisions that mankind are going to make, watches all the political movements of the nations, and then he, in turn, gives that to the prophets back in the old days, in the Old Testament, 2,500 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And that is how, like Jeremiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel and Daniel, the Bible claims they're 100% accurate. They never miss. In fact, the Lord says if they do miss, they weren't prophets.
They're not true prophets, right?
That's right. They have to be 100% accurate. And so prophecy from the scriptures is not prediction. It's historical fact.
All right, well, then what do we have when we have people like Gordon Michael Scallion and people of his stature who are incredible?
Radio Networks presents Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight's program originally aired May 18, 1999.
That's music that kind of goes down into the middle of your soul. You know, it's Lorena McKennitt. Morning, everybody. I'm Art Bell. Stuart Best is here, and he'll be right back. For those of you who got angry about Mike the Headless Chicken, didn't believe it, Felix in Lake Charles, Louisiana writes, oh yes, it's true, Life magazine covered it, and in fact, they covered another story, similar, in a way. It occurred to an American bomber pilot in World War II. A shell burst in his cockpit, took off most of his head, leaving enough of the brain intact for his headless body to unbuckle his seatbelt, get up and run to the back of the plane toward the door and pull his parachute cord before collapsing dead on the floor. That's a documented case history.
Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
When we have magnetite crystals surrounding our brain, that means that we as humans have everything necessary to make a transmitter or receiver, which is crystals.
Society seeks to persuade us that we are nothing more than material beings.
Hi, Art. Thousands of years ago, Egyptians were... You may recall my guest, Graham Hancock,
I've got to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. I saw one myself. I didn't see a light in the sky. I didn't see a vaguely, fuzzy object. What I saw came above my head, mm-hmm. It blanked out the stars and the moon. It was gigantic. It was triangular. It was silent. And it was moving. It was not flying. It was not in aerodynamic flight, Stuart. It was defying gravity. And this came over the head of myself and my wife, and we watched it go across the valley. I guarantee there are a few things in life I can guarantee, but I can guarantee you what I saw.
Absolutely. I don't question that a bit. My wife saw a very large triangular object when she left the bank one evening down in Menominee.
Really?
Very silent.
Yep.
Defying gravity. No sound, just floating along.
Okie doke. So we've got one or two things here. We've got either
let me tell you a story.
It's ours or it's theirs.
Well, let me tell you a story, and we'll... I had a friend of mine who was a lieutenant commander in the Navy.
Yes, sir.
And we were flying along one night up around 40,000 feet, and it gets kind of mesmerizing up there. But anyway, we were talking about UFOs, and he turned to me in all seriousness. He said, I have to tell you something. UFOs are real. The government knows they are real. And then he told me this story about a UFO landing out in New Mexico, some abandoned field somewhere.
When?
This would have been back probably in the 50s. And he said that government personnel and civilian high-level personnel came, got on board this UFO, were on there for 4 or 5 hours, got off, and then the thing left. And he swore to me that that was the truth.
This was who told, a pilot?
This guy was a pilot, and he had been a lieutenant commander in the Navy, and he flew the heavy aircraft. And I don't know exactly how he got involved in that particular instance, but he swore to me that it was the truth, and I have no reason to doubt him.
Well, now I got a story for you, and this is going to wind right back into what we're talking about. This occurred, I'm going to say, a month and a half ago. I got several faxes from pilots flying a cargo routes to Minneapolis-St. Paul who, this is tough stuff, Stuart, but the pilot and first officer both reported the fact that they were suddenly disoriented. They had the... There was a Northern Lights display going on, unlike one they've ever seen. You know, normally you see a shimmering. I lived in Alaska. I've seen it plenty of times.
Yes, we had one here not very long ago.
Yeah, they shimmer across the sky. But in this case, he said, at their altitude, 33,000, whatever it was, the entire sky was simply bright, and they felt extremely disoriented. And I read that fax on the air, and then the next day I got another facts from another pilot flying in the same area, except he said he had burns, literal, like he was sunburned, except for where his headphones were, you know, the headset they wear, like the one I wear when I'm on the air here.
Okay.
And he was actually burned in some way by
Probably a Tesla standing wave that they encountered.
A Tesla standing wave.
Well, what they've done, there's a combination between the United States and the Russians, and they have set up transmitting. You're familiar with HAARP, I'm sure.
I certainly am.
Okay, well, they have set up these huge transmitters, and these ELF transmitters, extremely low-frequency transmitters, are used to set up standing waves. And according to the information that we can get, many times the sky lights up.
Yes.
And then the next thing that can happen, of course, is a major earthquake, unusual storms, or severe lightning.
Are you aware that, I mean, we all, you know, there's much controversy, of course, about HAARP, but are there experiments going on or that have been going on that delve into Tesla technology that we don't know about? I mean, just forget about HAARP for a second.
Oh, absolutely. I think so. And the reason I think so is something that the scriptures say, that a fake Messiah arrives, with all lying signs and wonders. And if you go back into the book of Revelation, it more or less indicates that very high technology, we call them black operations, are used to fool the world.
To what end?
Well, this gets into something that sounds extremely strange, but sometimes truth is stranger than fiction.
All right, this is the home of stranger.
There's a fellow in Canada, he's dead now, but he produced a report on what was known as Project Bluebeam. And in that report, he said that they were going to use holographic transmissions to actually fake the arrival of a Messiah. And this Messiah would be seen all over the world. They would project it through various satellites.
Or I would suppose the ufology community might view it as an E.T.
Yes.
The religious community as a Messiah.
Yes, precisely. It would, no matter what nation you were in, this entity would be either speaking and or arriving as the Messiah that they expected. Now, the scriptures say that the world is going to go under what it calls a strong delusion. And I looked up the word strong, and it means extremely effectual. And
well, that would do it.
Yes. And because, you see, the elite rulers know that religion is the opium of the people. Mankind is spiritual. And so they play on that. And by that method, they could set up a fake Messiah.
I admit I'm no different. I am not a strict Christian, not even a very good Christian, maybe not even a Christian at all. But I believe in a creator, and believe me, if a Messiah arrived, I would be, I'm being honest with you, I'm sure I'd be taken in, you know, if the Messiah appeared real, if it really did seem like the return of our Lord,
mm-hmm.
I'd be taken in.
Well, it gets very interesting because now you're moving into the UFO area.
Well, maybe I am. Maybe I am. Hold, let's try one more before the top of the hour. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Stuart Best. Hi.
Hello.
Hello, where are you?
I'm in Atoka, Oklahoma.
Okay.
My name is Carl. I would like to speak about the polar shift for a couple of questions.
Go. Yes.
And also some comments on the UFO and the UFO agenda.
Well, we'll get as much as we can in.
Okay. In the polar shift, they take place at no specific time limits or time frames. They are caused by a desynchronization of the Earth's off-center core with the moon's orbital gravity grasp upon it. During that process, when it desynchronizes, the Earth's internal heat and gravity generation shuts down. At that point, the moon moves to a far distance away from the Earth as the Earth's gravity collapses. The atmosphere immediately expands and flash freezes the whole Earth.
Well, wouldn't the moon suddenly just leave its present orbit and either become erratic or leave altogether?
No, it just moves out as the Earth's gravity collapse.
But if we have no gravity, then what keeps the moon?
We have a weaker residual gravity of the Earth's matter makeup.
Okay, I see.
So that doesn't collapse. But that's what kills the land creatures.
Gotcha. Your theory, sir, is a little different than the traditional one about polar shifts, what causes them, but it sounds like you're saying the effect's about the same.
Yeah. As the moon moves out to its farthest distance, the moon itself turns over, and then when it comes back in as the Earth's off-center core dissipates and then realigns itself and picks up another little seed from the moon's gravity and the sun's gravity.
All right, look, we're way short on time here. You wanted to ask something about UFOs. What were you going to ask?
Being taught death education. For example, in that, they're made to lay down in open graves. They're made to write their own obituaries.
What?
Yes, this is going on, and it's going on all over.
Why?
Well, it's to separate the children from the parents. The teachers actually, and I don't know as they know that they're doing it, some of them definitely know it, that they're teaching the kids that the parents are archaic, their values are archaic, and, you know, we are into this new paradigm shift, and they have what they call values clarification courses, which to you and I would be no values at all. And these kids are being stripped of their very souls and their very spirits by this method. And it doesn't surprise me at all.
I'm really going to tell you that there was a time when I would have just tossed this kind of verbiage away, but you know what? You said soulless, and a lot of activity going on with our youth, to me, seems soulless.
It is.
I mean, literally, without soul, without regard for human life, without soul. I mean, sort of blank-eyed, different beings.
Well, they are. The scriptures call it a seared consciousness. They don't have any conscience. But I don't think you can blame the children. I think it goes into media, it goes into their schooling, it goes into the churches failing to instill moral ethics. I mean, we've got all kinds of problems within the churches. They're almost as bad now as what they would term the heathen. In fact, I would have to almost say the heathen probably act better than a lot of the people within the church.
Ooh.
And we have all kinds of problems that have developed, and it really is exactly what the scriptures say it is.
All right, a couple of calls. I want to take some calls, and then I want to ask you about UFOs. We've got a path to go down there for sure. Wildcard Line, you're on the air with Stuart Best. Hello.
Yes, hello.
Hi, where are you, sir?
This is Jim in Hawaii.
Hi, Jim.
Well, yeah, I just want to thank you, sir, for having Stuart on tonight.
Sure.
This is such an important message for the world and for our nation. I, myself, too, am a Christian. I've been a missionary overseas for quite some time. I'm back in the States now. But it's appalling to me what's happening in America now. It's shocking to everyone, of course, but we must realize we're in troublous times. And I'm sure Stuart would agree with me, too. As the dear book talks about, Satan himself has been cast down to this earth, along with a third of the angels, which rebelled against God and his plan. So there's, we've got our cards stacked against us. We've got all hell breaking loose here.
That's what
all hell breaking loose. Satan's plan is to destroy God's creation and the plan that he had. But, of course, he will fail in the end. We just have to keep going.
Not before a bunch of us go sailing off. All right, sir. Thank you very much. I take it you agree with that, certainly.
Oh, yes.
You've got something here called UFOs, Gateway to Hell.
Yes.
Now, what exactly do you mean by that? We are inundated now with the underlying star, meaning other stars, and his quote, they are really disturbingly similar to our sun. Stuart?
Yes.
You agree with that, I take it?
Absolutely.
So all of a sudden the science is really backing up what I know you deep in your heart believe biblically. Is that about right?
Yes. There is no question that the scriptures teach that the sun will give off 7 times the light it does now, and the moon will give off the light of the sun. Now, when you really stop and think about that, think about the changes upon Earth that would take place.
I can't see how we'd be here. If there was, forget 7 times the amount of sun, mm-hmm. If we had double the amount of sun we have now, intensity, we wouldn't be here.
Well, under normal conditions, that would be true. Now, it's very, very interesting that in the scriptures, it talks about the Lord shortening the days to save the elect.
Huh.
Now, because
prophecy is done in specific numbers of days. For example, the tribulation period is supposed to be...
That would be GSD, God's saving time.
Yes. Uh-huh. There are certain specific numbers of days. They cannot be shortened. So in the book of Revelation, it talks about that the sun gives off one-third less light, the moon one-third less light, and the stars one-third less light.
Well, that would be just every bit as catastrophic.
Well, what that means is that the Earth has changed its rotational speed, and a day is no longer 24 hours.
Of course.
It's 16 hours.
Of course. I'm with you. All right, I just briefly want to come back to what I said. I mentioned Columbine, horrible thing.
Yes.
But it was just the most recent. There's been a rash of, and now since, of course, they've found kids planning to blow up their schools and their parents and kill classmates and all the rest of this unbelievable crap going on. A sign of another sign, I take it.
Well, I believe it is a sign, but it's a sign of the moral order of the schools. If you go into the educational process, and I've read some books on this, and I assume that they're telling me the truth, that can be a dangerous word.
Yeah.
But in these books, they talk about...
This month in the After Dark magazine, read all about the magical powers of the human body, including psychometry, where everyday objects offer portals to other dimensions of information, or orgone energy. Maybe you shook hands with somebody and felt a surge of information about that person. It's all in the March issue of After Dark. Subscribe now by calling toll-free the new number, 1-888-261-6392. That's 1-888-261-6392. 1-888-261-6392.
Here's what you missed on Coast to Coast AM with George Norrie.
Do you think we'll get the bottom line answer to Roswell? Is anybody ever going to come forward and just solve this for us?
My answer is no. The government is not ever, ever, ever going to come clean on this case.
And we can't emphasize enough that this even exceeds the Oval Office. The idea that there are secret keepers and we don't elect them. We have no control over them, but yet they're controlling us. And to me, that's frightening.
Now, we take you back to the night of May 18th, 1999, on Art Bell, Somewhere in Time.
From Austin, Texas, ABC News said the following. Why are we confident the sun will burn reliably, keyword, reliably, for a few billion more years? Some sun-like stars have, their words, hiccuped occasionally, spewing out a burst of light so bright that it would melt ice on the moons of Saturn. According to Yale University astronomer Bradley Schaefer, they are very huge flares. I'm calling them super flares.
Networks presents Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight's program originally aired May 18th, 1999.
Good morning, everybody. Well, if a polar shift was about to occur, would you want to know, as the signs built, the signs in the sky, beneath your feet in the earth, as the compass began to deviate, would you want to know...
actually gotten out of its boundaries.
Boy, do I agree.
has violated its own, you know, constructions there and their charters.
NATO, after all, a North American treaty organization, right?
Yes.
It's supposed to be a defensive organization that was formed during the Cold War to prevent or to coordinate an attack should we be attacked by the Soviet Union, for example.
Yes.
Totally defensive. North Atlantic Treaty Organization. So it is a defensive organization that's now bombing the hell out of Yugoslavia, a sovereign nation.
Exactly. And the message that NATO has said to the world is very, very blunt when they released on this NATO 50th anniversary, when they said that from now on that NATO will have excursions beyond their own borders and apply weaponry to any nation that they feel deserves it.
And we are demonstrating that presently.
Yes.
Yes, no, indeed, that is correct. When it happened, I said on the air, and I say again tonight and now and evermore, that it was the first real giant step for the New World Order.
Absolutely. That's what it's all about.
I firmly believe that. Now, you've done a lot of work in this area. You believe this world order is coming, don't you?
Oh, I know it's coming. There's no way we can stop it. Absolutely no way we can stop it.
Will it precede the events that we've just been talking about with regard to the Earth changes, the polar shift, all the rest of it, or will it be what rises from the ashes?
Well, there's two ways of looking at that. I believe that right now we are under judgment. And as the world gets more materialistic and more evil, even though it professes itself to be good, we enter into World War III. And as you were talking about, this could well be the preliminaries of that war.
That's where the other ones began.
Yes, exactly. And as we progress into World War III, major destruction comes. And then, I believe, phase one of the major shifts in the Earth will begin to take place, and then there's going to be a calm period, a little bit of a calm period, in which the actual New World Order will rise up. In other words, this is just a preliminary. The New World Order, as far as we can figure out prophetically and from everything we can read politically and everything,
right,
is actually designed to fail, as we are seeing it today.
Designed to fail.
Yes, the United Nations, as it is right now, doesn't have any army. It has no power to tax, although it's been suggested that it could. And so let's say we have a major war. Well, then the peoples of the world would say, well, you know, if we had given this world government the power it needed, the armies that it needed, etc., etc., it might not have happened. Now,
I can see that as an after effect, you know, as the hearings are held, no doubt deep underground somewhere. if we had only done the following, well, it would have worked out, but we didn't. And so now the new order of things must be a one world without wars and without strife. And
that's right.
Many of us believe without a hell of a lot of freedom either.
Well, it has to come with no freedoms. Because if you follow the prophetic field or even some of the seers and the mystics, they all more or less agree that the control of people and the surveillance of people becomes almost unbearable.
Somebody sent me one sentence earlier today on a piece of paper, and it said something like, and I'm paraphrasing, it said the Constitution was a wonderful thing. We should go back to it.
Absolutely. In fact, if you wanted to stop most of what is happening here, I believe if the American government went back to the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, and if the people rose up and demanded it and changed their behavior...
You're lucky to get the people to rise up to change channels.
That's the problem. Indifference. That's the entire problem. They don't care anymore. And I believe the Lord is calling people to repentance. And I think that's what a lot of these earth changes come from. The Hopis mentioned that a lot of this occurs to draw attention to man's behavior.
Fine. Let's talk about that for a second, because that bothers the heck out of me. In other words, if the Lord, if our Maker is all-powerful, then why would he allow all of this suffering and death and change to occur? Is it some sort of cosmic joke on his part?
No, if you read in the scriptures, his reply is that they bring it upon themselves.
Back to that old free will thing, right?
It's actually free will. It's like the concept of hell. A lot of people say, well, how could a God of love and that kind of power assign people to such a terrible place? Well, the answer is he doesn't. They assign themselves. Mankind has been...
Wait a minute. These are the kind of questions that got me knocked out of Sunday school. because, after all, we are the Lord's creation. We are made in his image. And why didn't he make us better?
Well, you'd have to go back into the story of Genesis. The story of Genesis briefly was that God created man in his own image. And the image of God, if you search out the scriptures, is one of unconditional love. It's called agape in the Greek. And the Greek coined that word agape because they really didn't have any word to describe the love of God.
So what happened to us?
Well, the love of God required him to put into this garden, if you want to believe the story, and I certainly do.
Adam and Eve?
Of Adam and Eve. He put the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and that knowledge is experiential.
Yeah.
When they ate of that tree,
the fruit, they
changed their entire makeup. They no longer were pure love. They were a combination of experiential good and experiential evil. And from that, Genesis claims that after that, that the people were created not in God's image, but in the image of Adam. And there was a drastic change in our makeup. That's the essential story of the scriptures. That's the story of why Jesus Christ came into the world to redeem the world from the fall. Now the world, more or less...
So Adam basically screwed it up for all of us.
Everybody. Yeah. Yes, exactly. And the Lord came down, Jesus Christ came down to effect what he termed rebirth, in which the people of the world who would come to him could be, through this rebirth, have their spirits resurrected in the love that they originally had.
Mm.
And, of course, the world rejects that message, basically.
Well, all right, let's look around at a few other things. Columbine, children killing children, apparently mindlessly. Things that we absolutely can't understand. Columbine was just the worst and the biggest and the most recent, but it's been going on for several years now. This incredible problem with our young people. Now adult crime is going down.
Yes.
Robberies, rapes, all kinds of things like that are on their way down, but at the same time, this mindless, almost soulless activity on the part of our youth is on the rise.
Yes. There's a reason for it.
Yeah, I thought there might be. Hold on, Stuart. Stuart Best is my guest. And we are talking of many, many things. We're going to talk about UFOs, too. And what they are, and maybe what he thinks they are not. Anyway, we'll break here at the bottom of the hour. As the old saying goes, don't touch that dial. This is the largest overnight radio program in the history of radio. It's called Coast to Coast AM. I'm Art Bell.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
Traveling far, it's out of home.
access to a whole library of Art Bell Classic Somewhere in Time shows, available as streamed broadcasts. Plus, our fun live chat sessions, held twice a month. There's never been a better time to join Streamlink. Visit coasttocoastam.com today to sign up on our secure servers. You never know what you'll hear on Coast to Coast AM with George Norrie.
We know about the Illuminati. Their influence is worldwide. There really aren't countries anymore.
It's a corporate machine, and the population is becoming just simply an item for productivity management.
We're the drones for them, aren't we?
The public has been masterfully entertained for the last several decades as the boys took it all over by investment. Government is the actual true owner now of the banks, brokerage houses, insurance companies, and the large corporations by investment. There was a vacuum created in the public's comprehension to make sure they didn't look, as little bit by little bit, another piece was taken over, another piece was taken over, until government took over the entire ball of wax. Because everything we were told when we were little kids in grade school, Russia is a bad thing because the government owned and controlled everything. Well, when you actually look, government took over more control here in this country than Russia could have dreamed about.
Now, we take you back to the night of May 18th, 1999. On Art Bell, Somewhere in Time.
Well, you know, the story about Mike the Headless Chicken really made a lot of people angry. I don't know why. It's like they say, it can't be. It's not true. Well, go look. It's on my webpage right now. Mike the Headless Chicken is there. Mike lived 4 years without a head. I'm sorry. Like it or not, like it or lump it, it's a true story. It's an absolutely true story. Right now, we're going back to Stuart Best, and we're talking about something pretty freaky. It's a pole shift, and I just now got this in from Peter Davenport at the National UFO Reporting Center in Washington. Good evening, Art. And Ramona, he says he knows Ramona. Some interesting sightings over the western U.S. tonight, just in the last couple hours. The first report we received from a woman in San Antonio at about 2400 hours central. She alleges to have seen a prominent orange fireball with a long yellow tail move in level flight, that's underlined, in level flight from her right to left as she faced the southwest. Said it was very strange indeed, could not possibly have been an aircraft, a meteor, or anything else. Then at 2248 hours Pacific, 12 minutes earlier, a couple had a very interesting sighting of an oval object streaking across the sky in Ventura. No lights, very bizarre in appearance. 3 minutes prior to the latter sighting at 2315 Mountain, a witness allegedly saw a very strange triangular object near the Salt Lake City Airport. Also, there were apparently many witnesses to the explosion over northern Wisconsin last Thursday. It was very dramatic, they say. Peter. An explosion over Wisconsin, huh?
Well, we heard about it. I didn't actually see it.
You heard about it?
We didn't.
What's the deal?
Well, they said that somewhat like a mushroom cloud appeared after this loud explosion in the atmosphere for quite some time.
That's right. No. Now that you said mushroom cloud, I remember that you're absolutely right. A mushroom cloud appearance.
And we're going to see a lot of strange things from now on. It's like those reports. Now, some of them might be plasma balls, but obviously some may be U.S. military ops, or some may be what we're calling UFOs, whatever their source.
Here's one for you. Yesterday, Mount Baker snow, the fall for this year, broke the world's record, I say world's record, by 4 inches. The total now is 1,124 inches this year. Yes, Art, the snow is still falling today, repeating a world record in snowfall. Surprise you?
Not at all. In fact, a friend of mine lived by Mount Rainier, and he said the geologists up there have grave worries now because of the snow and the way it's operating, that if it breaks loose, there's going to be like 750 feet or 1,000 feet of snow just peel off the mountain and go into the valleys. A cataclysmic.
All right.
Snow slides.
Here is a fax from William in Portland. He says, as I'm listening to the description of the instant freeze and supersonic winds that would result from a polar shift, I think about Monte Cristo. Now, she's a lady I had on Fascinating, who is a caver. She goes way down into the earth, as deep as 10,000 feet. He asked, could a person live through such an event as is being described by Stuart Best underground?
Again, it would depend, I guess, on where you were. There's no question that there were some survivors in the days of Noah's flood, because in the book of Genesis it talks about the giants,
right?
And it said that there were giants in the earth in those days and also after that, meaning after the flood. Well, where did they go? Well, if you go into von Däniken's books and all those others, you would only come to the conclusion that some of them went underground and did survive. We're not positive that was a polar shift, but it certainly was catastrophic. And it would depend totally, I guess, upon where you were.
I suppose, and there's no real way to predict before an event of this sort, or is there, where the safe places might be?
No, there really isn't. Because we don't know exactly when the shift is going to take place or how that rotation of the earth is going to occur. There are some nations that are targeted for destruction. We do know that, or at least scripturally speaking.
Yeah, let me just guess that we might be one of them.
Yes, we are. There's no question about it that America is targeted for destruction.
Why?
Basically, from a scriptural viewpoint, I think it's because the people, according to God anyway, rejected the scriptures, and they went after everything else instead.
Or put a simpler way, behavior.
Yes. Yes. And the American people become, how do I say, totally materialistic, totally greedy on an average. Not everybody.
Well, it's a good thing that hasn't happened yet, huh?
And they start drifting away, and then, according to the scriptures, America takes the lead in forming a very evil, although it's presented as very benevolent, a world empire. And I think that's what we're involved in over there in Ukraine.
After Dark is the official magazine of Coast to Coast AM. Yes, it's a color magazine delivered to your mailbox every month. And this month, read all about the magical powers of the human body. Have you ever picked up an object and had a sudden impression of a place you've never been before? Or simply touched something and felt a strange sensation of something else? If so, you're experiencing psychometry, where everyday objects offer portals to other dimensions of information. Or maybe you shook hands with somebody and felt a surge of information about that person, or someone from the opposite sex affects you in ways that nobody else does. In that case, you're experiencing orgone energy. You can read all about that too in the March issue of the After Dark magazine. Subscribe now by calling our new toll-free number at 1-888-261-6392. That's 1-888-261-6392. It's $39.95 for 12 monthly issues. You can also go online at coasttocoastam.com.
Here's some exciting news for Coast to Coast fans. If you're already a Streamlink member, you know what a super value our subscriber service is. For around 15 cents a day, you get such great features as podcast. That's automatic downloads of Coast to Coast shows directly onto your computer desktop or MP3 player. But now, we've greatly expanded our full show library, so you have access to multi-year downloads. Imagine having hundreds of your favorite Coast to Coast shows right at your fingertips to listen to, collect, and take on the go with you.
Thank you. why, my love, what a tale my thoughts could tell. Just like an old-time movie about a ghost from a wishing well. In a castle dark or a fortress strong, with chains upon my feet, you know that ghost is me. And I will never be set free as long as I'm a ghost you can't see. If I could read your mind, love, what a tale your thoughts could tell. Just like a paperback novel, the kind the drugstore sells. When you reach the part where the heartaches come, the hero would be me.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
My guest is Stuart Best, and we are talking about the possibility of a really big, really quick change coming upon us, and the fact that these signs are out there right now.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
All right, I'm back to Stuart Best. Stuart, welcome.
Well, thank you.
What I just read you would seem to suggest not only the physical change that you talked about, but apparently a change in the creatures of the earth. Many gone, many new ones, many evolved. Survivors, to be sure, but a whole different place.
Well, of course, if you had a massive rearrangement of the earth's surface, it would cause tremendous shifting of everything. Animal life, bird life, plant life, and of course, as you know, in a major shift like that, your climates totally change. You go from like polar Arctic conditions to tropical conditions, and there is no question we have enough records, I think, to substantiate and prove
right
that polar shifts have occurred in the past.
Then. Obviously, it could occur again, and people are listening very carefully. So again, if you would, roll over what the signs would be that we're approaching one. You said rapid weather change for sure.
Well, you get rapid weather changes. There should be fluctuations in the magnetic poles.
Uh-huh.
There should be changes in the migratory habits of birds.
Oh, my.
Animals, because your magnetic pole is shifting.
You know, it's strange you should mention that, because there have been all these recent stories about, you know what homing pigeons are, right?
Yes.
Well, they released in several locations thousands of homing pigeons, and you know what? They didn't go home. They didn't go home.
They did.
Thousands and thousands of them, Stuart. We've been getting migratory reports that are just absolutely what I call head scratchers. You know, birds that ought to be flying south are flying north.
Mm-hmm.
Really weird stuff like that going on. And you're saying that's one of the signs.
Yes. In fact, we noticed that flying, when I was professionally flying back in the 60s, for example, you could get on top of most squall lines at around 30, 35,000 feet.
Yes, sir.
But as we approached the 80s, they really got up there.
Who did you fly for, and in what kind of planes?
Well, we were flying the Gulfstreams, the Falcon jets, the Lockheed Jetstars, that sort of thing. So we were getting up there quite a ways in the atmosphere. But we noticed a change in the violence of storms, and the tops were
it's not uncommon now for the tops to be 50, 60,000.
As a matter of fact, the Oklahoma storms the other day were well over 60,000 feet.
Yes, that does not surprise me at all. We noticed that change, and that's just one more of the changes. Then you would have greater earthquakes that will come in various places on the earth.
Again, strange you should mention that. A mammoth right now is going through the most incredible swarm I have ever seen. We've even had a 5.0. There was an earthquake the other day in Kansas City. As a matter of fact, I got about 8 earthquake reports tonight. Earthquakes going on all over the place in odd places where you wouldn't expect. Kansas City, for heaven's sakes.
Well, I think you're going to see earthquakes in places where they have not been before. We issued a warning to the people out there around the Mammoth Lakes area, Oregon, into California, down through California, down through San Diego.
Yes.
That they should consider possibly even moving. That area is definitely going to go under the water.
Under the now, what area was that again, please? Oregon.
Well, it's going to go inland from Oregon down through a good share, I believe, of California. And if you follow any of the visionaries of Earth changes.
I follow them all.
Well, you know how their maps lie. I mean, it goes inland quite a ways.
And about a 6-foot map, the most incredible thing you've ever seen from Gordon Michael Scallion.
Yes, we have that.
Who's a very good friend of mine, the Earth changes map. And frankly, Stuart, I'm not here.
Well, you would have seacoast property for a little while, and then you'd probably be under the water. Because if you follow what these people are saying, and you go into the geological data,
yes.
All of the lines, all of your fracture zones, are exactly where they say all the major activity is going to occur.
Uh-huh.
And California is in serious trouble. And if you follow down through from the Great Salt Lake, and it kind of curves down around towards San Diego, that whole area, Mammoth Lakes, I think, is a very dangerous place.
Something is getting ready to happen at Mammoth. And if not now, then in the next cycle. But this cycle is amazing. What's going on right now at Mammoth is incredible. If anybody doubts that, go up to my website. We've got a link to this earthquake map, and look at Mammoth. It's like they put little pinpoints where the earthquakes are,
mm-hmm.
and there have been hundreds and hundreds of earthquakes in the last few days. It's really weird.
Well, not only are you having microquakes there, you're having some major quakes.
Yeah, above 5, actually.
Yes.
Above 5. And I guess what could occur there, I am told, is literally the birth of a new volcano eventually. Is that?
Oh, absolutely. Are you familiar with Phoenix Rising, Mary Summer Rain?
I certainly know the name Mary Summer Rain, yes.
Well, anyway, she wrote a book called Phoenix Rising. And in that book, she talks about this Indian prophetess named No Eyes, whose prophecies are very stunningly accurate. And she made mention of the fact that volcanoes are going to rise again where they've been basically dormant, and that new ones are going to be popping up all over the place.
Well, let me tell you something I did, Stuart. I don't know, maybe you've heard the shows, maybe you've heard people talk about the show, I don't know. But I did something that I don't think anybody else has really done on radio. I had a Hopi elder on, a very serious Hopi elder. He didn't speak English, and we had to have a translator, and it was kind of ponderous to do on talk radio. But he said that he wanted to come on the air, Stuart, because what was about to happen to Earth was just about to happen. I mean, that it was so close that the normal counsel that he would keep, which would be his very own and nobody else's, had to change. He felt like he had to warn us, and he laid it out, Stuart, that essentially what you're describing is virtually, his words, upon us now.
Well, I believe that. Biblical chronologists, for example, all seem to converge in around the 1997-2010 area. And your mystics and your psychics and visionaries all say about the same time zone. Like a case, for example, places the polar shift, I believe, between 1999 and 2000, somewhere in there.
There's a particular unsettling reference in one of the quatrains to the seventh month, which could be interpreted to be July or September, I'm told, of this year. I'm told that by various people, all bets are off in 99. I mean, whether it's a remote viewer, whether it's somebody like Gordon Michael Scallion and other seers, people who have had visions, people who have had NDEs, near-death experiences, and been told by beings of light or whatever, you know, you hear all kinds of things. The thing that worries you, if you're listening carefully, is that they're all saying roughly the same thing. That's what's bothered me.
Well, everything is converging upon the same time zone, and we are beginning to see we have this war developing now over in Yugoslavia. A lot of the Earth changes parallel the political affairs of man.
There are many, many people, Stuart, who believe that what's happening in Yugoslavia right now is the ignition of World War III.
Well, I believe it is, actually, but I think that part of it will come a little bit later. What we're doing is we're forcing an alliance between Russia, China, India, and all of the Muslim nations there.
That's actually going on right now. The Russians have had envoys in China since we bombed their embassy, one of our more brilliant recent moves. And they're getting together, and God only knows what they're talking about.
Well, what they're talking about is the destruction of the United States. I can guarantee you that.
Yeah, somehow I didn't think they were comparing notes on Siberia.
Yeah, another nation you have to watch is Turkey. Turkey right now is in the Israeli-NATO alliance.
Did you know they just gave permission to fly planes out of Turkish bases to bomb in Yugoslavia?
Well, I wouldn't doubt it, but I am a little bit suspicious because biblically, Turkey does not align itself with Israel. It is one of the enemies of Israel. So either Turkey is playing games to get military intelligence from both the Israelis and NATO and American equipment, or there is going to be a shift in political leadership there. And it will shift over to a more rabid Islamic coalition than is presently there.
So it's easy to see the correlation in what the Bible says will occur, what, Stuart, in the final days? What we call the final days?
Yeah, I think everybody calls it the Hopis call it the time of the purification.
That's right.
Or the cleansing.
That's
the Bible refers to it as a tribulation period.
Right.
And it gives specific political alliances that will come into being as the time of the end approaches. The key one being a surprise attack on Damascus by Israel. It's a preemptive attack, destroys Damascus.
Wouldn't surprise me. They certainly have shown a propensity in Israel for preemptively striking something they regard as a national endangerment, nuclear facilities, whatever.
Yes. And the reason they do it, I'm sure, is for exactly the reason you just gave. They preempt because of Russian-Syrian ties, which are now closely developing, rearming of Iraq, the rearming of Iran, and that's another dangerous area. And it would not surprise me if the United States gets involved in a, a three-pronged war. North Korea is heating up. We've been, of course, bombing Iraq regularly. It's just not in the news. But according to the biblical prophecies, the United States has at it with both Iran and Iraq. It's referred to as Persia. And it's a tremendous war, but it's over very quickly, and we come out the winner in it.
Yeah.
And I believe, as mankind...
But isn't that kind of like winning the battle and losing the war?
Oh, absolutely.
Because that's just another notch toward what's coming, right?
Exactly. What we are doing systematically is turning the nations of the world against us. And according to the scriptures, at a time when we least expect it, they launch a nuclear attack.
Well, I've been trying to wrap my mind around the concept of bombing for peace since it began, and I haven't been able to do it. I think we're out of our minds, but anyway, you view this as just one little step toward an eventuality that you think is, what's your best guess? How far away?
Well, I believe it could be as close as this fall, and it's most likely going to be within the next 10 years. And if nothing at all happens during that period of time, we've probably got a gap of about 30 years from biblical chronology. And I say that because most biblical chronologists base a 2,000-year period from the birth of Christ to his return.
Right.
Now, if that is not based upon the birth of Christ, but rather the crucifixion, that would jump it ahead, you see, another 30, 33 years.
Oh, I see. So it depends on how you date it, from the birth or from the death.
Yes, and most chronologists would date it from the birth.
I would think so.
And the signs that were given were deep and powerful earthquakes, famines, pestilences, which are rising again. And then a strange comment about fearful signs coming from the heavens, which is reminiscent of Gordon Michael Scallion's comment about the haze, the green haze. Mary Summer Rain's Indian prophetess Noyes said that a green haze develops. Hopi prophecy claims that there is a kind of a mystery haze.
Green haze.
And who knows what other signs, if the Book of Enoch...
How might that be manifested scientifically? Can you imagine a condition that would produce a green haze?
Electromagnetic. Tremendous electromagnetic storms. I think as we approach this cycle, we'll reach its apex, according to the reports I have, between February and March of 2000.
All right.
It's
building quite rapidly right now. Cycle 23 is really on the go at the moment. We're having flare after flare after flare after flare.
Yes, and this could build. It seems as though we're entering a period where nature is going slightly out of kilter, out of balance. And the comments of the Lord that we would see signs in the moon, when you couple it with Enoch's comments that the moon will no longer keep its course, the Book of Revelation talks about either an asteroid or a comet hit that we take. It appears as though the solar system and the entire galaxy is rising up into an area where we're going to be involved in some different, shall we say, configurations where we will be entering into comet, asteroid fields, and space debris that's out there.
Well, already we've had all of these reports of these giant fireballs. Now, most times, green fireballs, for example, different colored fireballs, aside from the anomalous nature of some of the reports, we'll get to that, the fireball reports have been astounding. I mean, we're not really in any known meteor storm period, and yet over the last year or so, these reports have just been piling up like crazy.
Well, there was a scientist that did some, I can't remember his name, but I do remember reading the report, and he claimed that when major earthquake activity was going to begin, that plasma balls would form in the atmosphere.
Really?
And he collated these plasma balls with the introduction of major earthquake activity.
Well, then if it's not objects entering the atmosphere and it's plasma balls, that might explain why occasionally we get reports that plasma balls hover in midair. Because, you know, rocks don't do that. They fall, right? Anyway, we're going to break here at the top of the hour, and we'll be right back with Stuart Best. This is Coast to Coast AM.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight, featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999. Somewhere in Time on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from May 18, 1999.
Before you dismiss what Stuart Best is saying about a polar shift, you better listen closely. From the Seattle Times, Friday, July 25, 1997, in case you want to check, dramatic land shift may explain rapid change in creatures. This was by Robert Cook in Newsday. 500 million years ago, continents shifted 90 degrees, migrating rapidly from polar regions to the tropics and vice versa, in a global upheaval that may help explain the sudden increase in the diversity of creatures on the planet. The new theory is the first to tie together the strange series of global events that occurred during the mysterious time period known as the Cambrian Explosion. During that period, apparently all kinds of creatures went away and all kinds of creatures appeared on the face of the Earth. This surprising new data was published today, meaning back then, by two scientists and colleagues at the California Institute of Technology. So before you dismiss anything, you better consider that. Boy, you've done a lot of stuff. I definitely have heard of all the Iron Mountain stuff that you've done. I've heard a lot about that. And you did all that, huh?
Oh, yes.
The Atlantis Chronicles?
Well, the Atlantis Chronicles was a research video that we did to try and find out the truth about Atlantis and what it was really all about, and it's a very interesting video. That took 4 hours. It's a four-hour video.
Four-hour video. UFOs?
That's a seven-hour video.
Gateway to Hell?
That's part of it. It's UFOs Gateway to Hell, actually, with a question mark.
Oh, boy, are we going to talk about that. But, you know, what I first want to talk about is something that we know that occurs, and a million people have sent me articles on this. We have the North Pole and the South Pole.
Mm-hmm.
And we've always known it that way. North Pole's north, South Pole's south. And so it is. But it may not have been that way forever, and there is significant scientific evidence, perhaps even conclusive, that there have been prior polar shifts. In other words, where north goes south and south goes north, right?
That's right.
Now,
absolutely.
Now, how many times in our Earth's history do we think this has occurred?
Well, it depends on the experts you look at, but from what we can gather, probably 7 to 8 times, they're just, I think partially they're guessing because of records, but it has happened a considerable number of times. From a biblical perspective, there is at least probably 2. I believe there was one before the creation of Adam and Eve,
mm-hmm.
that you'll find in Genesis. And then it appears as though when the time of Noah's flood came, that also may have incorporated at least a partial polar shift, if not a total one. And then a very interesting event occurred in the days of Peleg, which occurred maybe 250 to 300 years after the flood, in which it says the earth was divided, and that would have been a gigantic earthquake, which, according to the ancient records, set up the nations as we know them today.
The continents? Did it actually change continental formations? I mean, all right, well, let's get down to it. What do we think occurs? Oh, God, so many questions. First of all, how quick would a polar reversal occur?
Well, the actual polar reversal, from what we can gain from the scriptures and from other documents, ancient documents, it occurs very rapidly, usually within a one-day period. So it occurs, when it finally goes,
a
it goes extremely rapidly.
A one-day period?
Yes.
And in one day, the North Pole goes to roughly the South Pole, or some new location, and South goes to North?
Yes.
Okay, if that were to occur, what is our best guess about what would happen?
Total destruction, basically. It would depend on where you were on the Earth's surface at the time the shift occurred, the direction of the shift.
Let's say I'm in Nevada.
I would think from the prophecies you'd be in a lot of trouble.
Well, what do you mean?
I think everybody in the United States of America is going to be in a lot of trouble. Because a shift...
Divine trouble.
Destruction.
You mean dead?
Death, yes.
Yes. Well, what would kill us?
Well, let me just quote you from Isaiah, for example. Behold, the Lord maketh the earth empty and maketh it waste.
Yep.
And turneth it upside down, and scattereth abroad the inhabitants thereof.
Okay, translate that into what that might mean scientifically.
Well, scientifically, that would mean that in a very short period of time, the North Pole becomes the South Pole,
right.
And actually probably goes beyond it.
Sure.
Because...
No, but I mean effects. When that happened, what...
Total destruction.
By what means?
By means of, shall we say, outside, almost outer space, cold coming down to the surface.
Oh.
The scriptures indicate a tremendous roll cloud develops. If you've seen major squall lines, you've seen these roll clouds.
Oh, listen, brother, I used to chase them.
I chased them
looking for tornadoes, so yes, I'm extremely familiar with a roll cloud.
Okay, now multiply that roll cloud by a tremendous margin, because what happens is the surface of the Earth changes directions rapidly, but the atmosphere above it does not.
Wait a minute. The surface of the Earth changes directions.
Right. In a shift... The Earth is tilted at approximately 22.5, 23.5 degrees.
Right.
All right. Now, when a shift occurs,
right.
That tilt, the Earth, the North Pole, starts to slide to the south. Now, as it slides to the south, it is fairly solid, so the crustal part of the Earth just simply slides. But the Earth, or the atmosphere, does not... catch up with it. It doesn't just move with it.
Oh, my God. You know, I once had somebody on here talking about polar shift, and he said there would be 800-mile-per-hour winds.
Oh, I would think probably at least that, probably even more.
And so if I just heard you correctly, you're saying the Earth's surface would move, but the atmosphere wouldn't. The net effect, though, would be atmosphere moving by us, or us actually, it wouldn't make any difference. The net effect would be stupendous winds.
Yes. Yes. In fact, the atmosphere would actually
begin to roll back as the surface of the Earth accelerates in the shift.
My.
Because the atmosphere cannot keep up with it, it begins to roll back, and it creates a huge vacuum area.
For the first time, I understand this.
And then air from the outer space comes down because it's super cold, and you have instant freeze of anything that happened to be there that would...
I take it you mean actually upper atmosphere,
yes.
the very thinner, very cold upper atmosphere.
Yes.
Anybody who's ever been at in an airplane, one of the recent 747s, when you look at the outside temperature and you're only at like 40,000 feet, the outside temperature is like minus 80, minus 90 degrees typically.
Yeah, it gets pretty chilly up there.
Just that far up. So further up in the atmosphere, of course, it's if that were to suddenly come down...
Well, you have instant freeze, which probably explains the... findings in Siberia and whatnot.
You mean the vegetation and the woolly mammoths?
Yes. Instant freeze. They were quick frozen in a split second. The only thing that would do that is super cold air approaching, you know, because of wind chill factors.
And it would have to be very fast.
Oh, instantaneous. They would never know what hit them. Nobody would know what hit them.
Huh.
There will be warning signs.
Like what?
Well, we're already getting the warning signs. We're seeing changes in the weather patterns. The patterns are getting more and more violent.
Boy, I'll tell you, there's no question about that.
I think we're in the preliminary stages of a polar shift.
Of a polar shift. Now, you know, let me tell you a little story. This is a true story. I could read it because I've got it here somewhere, but I know it by heart. The Fujita scale of tornadoes actually goes to 12, but that's just an academic study.
Mm-hmm.
On Earth, in our atmosphere, it is impossible to have any, the scientists say anyway, meteorologists, impossible to have anything greater than what's called an F5 tornado at 318 miles per hour. Now, that's exactly what we had, was 318 miles per hour. That is the top, the very tip-top of the F5 scale. At 319, which, by the way, they think they might have actually had, you would have an F6. And they say that's impossible. And yet, it occurred. And everybody who's been watching the weather maps knows the horrendous, horrendous tornado season that we've had. And you're saying this is a harbinger.
Yes, absolutely. In fact, it's going to increase tremendously.
Then there's one more thing, and I've been dealing with this on my show now for 2 years, so I'll tell you about it. You can tell me if it means anything, Stuart, but from time to time, I will suddenly start getting all these emails and faxes, and people will start saying to me, hey, Art, guess what? My compass is suddenly deviating anywhere between 8 to 15 degrees west, and it's freaky. It's like the pole is wandering a little bit, and then it comes back.
Mm-hmm. Well, a magnetic pole shift probably will precede the actual literal pole shift. When the magnetic pole shift and go into, I guess what you could call a dipolar reversal, there is a period of time in which the magnetic field actually collapses, according to the scientists that have studied this.
In other words, goes to zero.
Goes to zero. During that time, of course, you have... all the lethal rays from the sun, et cetera, et cetera. Your
cardio
mass ejections and all that.
Nothing to protect you from them, right?
That's right, because it's the magnetic field that actually does most of the protecting, which is one of the reasons why your satellites and or manned satellites are below the Van Allen belt, because they're protected by the Van Allen belt itself from the more lethal rays of the sun.
So if suddenly... it went to zero, in essence, we would be immediately, particularly if it's a bad solar cycle time, which, by the way, we happen to be coming up on.
Yes.
A solar maximum, they say, perhaps within the next year. You would then be wide open to a coronal mass ejection that could flip the poles?
Yes. Well, I don't know if it would actually literally create the polar shift.
but it could certainly rearrange the magnetic poles tremendously. And there are some scientists that have done some research on this, and they claim that when the poles go to zero, that it has tremendous effects upon the Earth, great shaking of the Earth, and then it reorientates itself, and the North Pole becomes the South Pole, et cetera, et cetera.
Stuart, I have a fellow I interview from time to time named Major Ed Dames from SciTech, which is a remote viewing organization. He has remote viewed something that he calls a kill shot from the sun, and it sounds an awful lot like what you're talking about.
Could well be. There's no question that the sun is involved in this, because the time of the polar shift, according to the scriptures, and the time of a solar nova are the same. The Bible indicates in the Old Testament that the moon will give off the light of the sun, and the sun will give off seven times the light it has now. Now, that can only be described as a mini nova.
You know, it's interesting you should mention this, because I've been reading these stories just in the last few days about scientists seeing these suns go into this apparent nova condition a lot lately. I mean, they've got all kinds of new information about it, and if other suns can do it, I mean, our sun is not that unusual.
That's right.
It could do it too, couldn't it?
It not only could, according to the prophecies, it will. And actually, the way the Lord worded it, he said the heavens will be shaken, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. In other words, things sort of go off from their normal course. The Book of Enoch says the moon shall change its laws and not be seen for its proper period.
Would anybody on Earth live through such an event?
Yes, there are survivors. According to the scriptures, there are survivors.
Well,
not many.
How about
there are.
Scientifically? I don't in any way put down the scriptures, and I realize you're coming at this from a Christian perspective, which is fine. But scientifically, if what you suggest occurred, how would anybody live?
I think, again, it would depend on your location upon the planet in relationship to the spin of the polar shift itself. In other words, if you were in an area where you were sort of in the pivot area, probably not a whole lot would happen to you. But those on the outside of the shift, you see, would have tremendous damage.
Oh, I absolutely do see. In other words, inside, you would hardly feel the motion. Outside, you'd be thrown from here to Kalamazoo.
Yes.
All right, hold on, Stuart. Stuart Best is my guest, and we'll be right back.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from May 18, 1999.
After Dark is the official magazine of Coast to Coast AM. Yes, it's a color magazine delivered to your mailbox every month. And this month, read all about the magical powers of the human body. Have you ever picked up an object and had a sudden impression of a place you've never been before? Or simply touched something and felt a strange sensation of something else? If so, you're experiencing psychometry, where everyday objects offer portals to other dimensions of information. Or maybe you shook hands with somebody and felt a surge of information about that person. Or someone from the opposite sex affects you in ways that nobody else does. In that case, you're experiencing orgone energy. You can read all about that, too, in the March issue of the After Dark magazine. Subscribe now by calling our new toll-free number at 1-888-261-6392.
That's 1-888-261-6392. It's $39.95 for 12 monthly issues. You can also go online at coasttocoastam.com.
You never know what you'll hear on Coast to Coast AM with George Norrie.
We know about the Illuminati. Their influence is worldwide. There really aren't countries anymore.
It's a corporate machine, and the population is becoming just simply an item for productivity management.
We're the drones for them, aren't we?
The public has been masterfully entertained for the last several decades as the boys took it all over by investment. Government is the actual true owner now of the banks, brokerage houses, insurance companies, and the large corporations by investment. There was a vacuum created in the public's comprehension to make sure they didn't look as little bit by little bit. Another piece was taken over, another piece was taken over until government took over the entire ball of wax. Because everything we were told when we were little kids in grade school, Russia was a bad thing because the government owned and controlled everything. Well, when you actually look, government took over more control here in this country than Russia could have dreamed about.
Now, we take you back to the night of May 18th, 1999, on Art Bell, Somewhere in Time.
Well, all right, here we go. Here is Stuart Best. Stuart, welcome to the program.
Well, thank you for having me, Art. I really appreciate it.
Sure. Where are you, by the way?
We're just east of the Twin Cities, about 80 miles. We are in a small town called
Iron Mountain 3, the Atlantic Atlantis Chronicles, Harbinger of Trouble, Comet Hale-Bopp, UFOs, Gateway to Hell, Daniel and the Four Beast Powers, and much more. Author of 8 investigative reports, books, From Babylon is Rising to Daniel and the Four Beast Powers. This is obviously going to be a very, very, very interesting interview. And so we're going to talk about all kinds of things. I think we are going to begin in a moment with a polar shift. Now, what is a polar shift? If you'll stay right where you are, you're about to find out. Actually, 22 video productions, but including Iron Man. Riding and slipping and sliding, it's magic. And you, as you swim to side, you can go higher and higher, baby. It's a
Radio Networks presents Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight's program originally aired May 18, 1999.
And I'm getting a lot of faxes that are saying, on Mike the Headless Chicken, BS, we don't believe it. Well, it's a UPI story, folks. You can pull it out of the archives. It was back in 45. It's true. Mike the Headless Chicken, who lived for 4.5 years. Moreover, we've got a photograph of Mike up on the website right now. Just go down and go to Neil Slade's name and click on it, and you'll see Mike the Headless Chicken, who lived. He lived until he choked on a kernel of corn stuffed down his feeding neck. It's the truth. I don't care what you say. You can read the UPI story. Well, all right. Stuart Best is coming up shortly. He is an author, video producer, lecturer, audio news tapes, and so forth. He's a former professional corporate jet pilot, for 25 years. Worked for Fortune 500 companies like General Electric, Northern Pacific, Burlington Northern, and so forth. Then he retired into professional photography, portraits, and commercial special effects. Moved into video production, documentaries on the enigmas of the world, and Christian prophecy, which range from the political affairs of mankind, earth changes, and the coming polar shift. How many of you know what a polar shift is? It may not be a good thing, but it has occurred many times in Earth's past. So he's also, by the way...
One inch, right smack dab between the back of your eyeball and your ear. Okay, so that's where it is.
Now, do we need both switches clicked? Is that better, or will one do the trick?
Normally, they work in tandem, but they can't. But you can control them independently. You can click the right one forward and the left one backward. For example, if you wanted to do visual types of activities with non-verbal activities, then the right click switch would be forward and the left click switch would be in neutral.
Gotcha.
If you wanted to write a book, for example, or poetry, or if you wanted to do a fancy math problem, you would click the left click switch forward and then leave the right switch in neutral. Or you could play music while you're trying to write a book,
so that way
you have them both click.
So that way you could do your homework effectively, but if your roommate bothered you, you could sock him in the jaw.
Well, you could.
All right, but let's say we want a cloud bust,
yes,
which is something that you and I began with, and either punch a hole in a cloud or cause a cloud to dissipate, or maybe even the other way around, cause one to form.
Yes.
People are going to think we're nuttier than fruitcakes talking about this.
I just saw a picture of someone else doing this in an older book, one of these Time Life books, and they had a series of photographs. Now, if they go to my website, they'll see my videotape of me doing this.
Well, we have got the link up there right now. When you say your website, a video, did you say?
Yes. There's a couple of dedicated pages to the cloud busting phenomenon.
You mean it actually shows a cloud being busted?
Oh, I went in my backyard with my video camera, without practicing, without doing any second takes or third takes, and I said, okay, I'm going to point the camera up in the sky, and I put the cloud in the middle of the viewfinder, and I said, I'm going to make this one dissipate. And within 3 minutes, that cloud was gone. And then I said, okay, let's point it at another
and
part of the sky.
My God, you've got this in moving video on the site?
Yeah, it's on real audio that they have. So we did there's a time lapse.
Right.
Explanation on the website as well, plus the picture. So
well, a lot of people have the G2 player because they watch my program, which, you know, if they get the G2 player, they can see me here doing the show for whatever that's worth.
This will show even on the old Real Audio version 5. So
okay.
If you've got the old or the new one, you can look at that.
Cool.
At my website.
Cool.
But you want a real quick instruction for people just to get started. You know, they can always get the books and get into the detail of it. But if you can imagine that you just have these click switches, see, 1 inch inside each head, and the amygdala comes from the Greek word meaning nut or almond, and it's actually a little walnut-shaped protuberance inside your brain.
Yeah.
And it's about the size of the tip of your thumb. Okay?
Oh,
so you've got one in the left hemisphere and one in the right here. Now, if you can imagine, you have a feather, right? And if you tickle the front part of that amygdala on the left side and then use the feather and tickle it on the right side, just that process of imaginative tickling,
yes,
that will automatically click that amygdala forward and cause electrochemical activity to occur in the frontal lobe.
We'll call that an American tickler.
It's like a jump start. Yes, an American tickler. That's good. That's good.
And so once you have done that...
Once you've done that, then it begins a process. And the more you do this tickling and all the other ways that you can click your amygdala forward, you actually begin to build physically new neural connections
into the frontal lobes and throughout the frontal lobe.
I understand you can
and
do that.
This changes everything. Some people, some people listening to the radio tonight, they'll lie down in bed and they'll do this. And I get reports from people who see colors, their whole body begins to vibrate.
Right.
Just amazing things. Most of us, it's more subtle. You accumulate the effects of opening up the frontal lobes, and then you start, after time and practice of clicking the amygdala forward as you go through your daily activities, the EST begins to happen spontaneously, the telepathy happens spontaneously.
Gotcha.
Without you even trying, you just notice these things start to happen.
Wow.
Now, Lingo up at the Brain Lab, he actually did standardized testing of people who understood the layers of their brain and how to click their amygdala forward, and he measured huge jumps in the Stanford-Binet IQ test, 500 to 1,400% increases in what's known as the Getzelf-Jackson Creativity Index.
Wow, wow, wow.
People experience spontaneous creativity, and probably most importantly, once you start clicking the amygdala forward and getting out of the reptilian part of the brain,
right,
you start to have immediately start to increase physical and emotional pleasure.
All right, listen, we don't have a whole lot of time tonight. There's one hard question I want to ask you. If somebody got really proficient, as you would be, I would presume, could you cause somebody else's amygdala to click forward externally? In other words, as you get better and better at externalizing the power that you're acquiring,
yeah,
could you do that?
You can't help yourself but do that. It's contagious. If you're beaming and radiating wonderful energy and you're feeling great, it's osmosis.
Listen, I would like to have a way. How can people contact you, or do you want to plug a book, or what?
Sure. Since I've talked to you, I've written a brand new playbook guidebook with your audience in mind. It's very, very easy to understand, and it's a month-long series of daily, one-a-day activities that anybody can understand.
All right.
Whether you're 10 or 65 years old. It's called Brain Magic.
Brain Magic.
Brain Magic.
Good title.
And, of course, they can get it through the website as well.
All right, well, obviously, we've got a link up there right now. Is there an email address where anybody can contact you?
Sure. It's N. Slade.
That's N as in Nora, Slade, S-L-A-D-E, all together.
Yes, at h2net.net.
All right, again, everybody, N. Slade, that's N-S-L-A-D-E, at H as in Honolulu, 2 net.net.
That's correct.
And the email will go to Neil. Neil, what you and I are going to do is to plan an entire program, but with Mike here, I had to have you on because otherwise, without the photograph, without the story, without Neil Slade, nobody would have believed this.
Well, it was very nice talking with you again, and I'm glad to hear from you again.
Neil, let's...
And I look forward to our next conversation.
Let's plan a whole show. We'll do that, all right?
All right.
Thank you very much.
Bye, Art.
Good night, Neil. That's Neil Slade. Man, it's absolutely amazing stuff, you've got to admit. I'm sorry I wasn't alive to see Mike. I was a little guy then, and I wouldn't have known Mike from Shinola. Well, with that in mind, we're going to break here. And when we come back, we're going to be talking about polar shifts. This is Coast to Coast AM.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight, featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
Oh,
don't even see the neck. All right, I frankly don't see the neck. Now, I want to know a little bit about that. Neil, I'm looking at this and it's gross.
It is gross. You know, after I sent you the fax, I thought, maybe Art's never going to talk to me again.
Oh, no. This immediately got my attention. Now, there's actually an indentation where Mike's head should have been, where Mike's neck should have been.
I guess it's the way the feathers poof up, you know, on a rooster, that particular kind of rooster. So, you know, if you were to take all the feathers off the chicken, you
then
know,
you'd see the...
You would see it, but I think that's...
It's better this way, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, God. All right, so we have obviously then proven that at some level, all the basic levels, a chicken or even a human, if they lopped off a human's head just the right way, I suppose.
Well, you, like I said, you can remove entirely half of the human brain.
All right.
And
so,
nothing happens.
All right, so these are the basic... functions, breathing, heartbeat, all the other basic...
Body temperature,
fight
or flight response.
Yeah.
They're all in this innermost part of the brain, the brain stem or the reptile brain.
All right. Then let's take a second and talk about the rest of the brain, which is the bigger part of it. And that's where you come in, really.
Okay.
So what do we use the rest of this for?
Well, the next level up, it's sort of like the next level out. The brain is kind of organized. I'm trying to think like a jawbreaker. You know how it changes color as you go further and further in.
Yeah.
Or like an apple. You know, the reptile brain might be like the seeds of the apple, and then around the seeds is this core part, which is a little bigger. And this is called what scientists now call the mammal brain, and it adds on emotions and very basic social skills. Now dogs and cats have a reptile brain, and then they've got this mammal brain part over it, too.
Right.
So, you know, as you get into your pets, we know that our pets have emotions, and they know how cooperative behavior works.
That's right.
Okay? But the humans and primates go even much further beyond that, and they add another big part of the brain called the primate brain, and then the frontal lobes. Now, if everyone is listening, if they were just to take their hand, you can just, as I'm explaining this, just take your hand and hold on your forehead, okay?
On both sides?
Well, you can hold on your, you could probably, unless you've got an extremely large head or very small hands, you can hold on your whole forehead with one hand.
Yeah, oh, yeah, that's true.
Everything underneath your fingers is called the frontal lobes, and that's the front third of the brain.
Right.
And that's evolutionarily the most advanced part of the brain. And in humans, that's where we compute cooperative behavior and intuition and imagination and creativity and logic. That's why humans can do things that other animals can't do.
Sure.
And that's also where all the paranormal abilities seem to generate, is in these frontal lobes.
And it is your firm contention that it is possible to, in effect, click a switch, turn on the amygdala, is it?
Yes, well, right.
I'm getting better.
I swear. Now, when you called me this evening, I didn't recognize your voice because you sounded like a person 10 years younger. I swear you must have been using more of your brain and clicking your amygdala forward since I talked to you last.
No, Neil, the truth should come out, and what I'm doing is I'm flying to a secret location where they're administering this new experimental youth serum. Well,
you're serious?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I'm a good 10 years. I'm 10 years easily.
I swear to God.
I really can't talk about it, but
it's... I thought, who is this?
Yeah, I know. And people on the street have been telling me that. My God, you look younger. And I've just been sort of smiling at them. Yeah, I know. You know, I take a little shot of this stuff, and, well, it's expensive. Anyway, going back to the paranormal, getting to the paranormal, really, it is possible, through a mental process, to click forward this imaginary switch.
Oh, it's not imaginary.
Well, I mean, you've got to imagine it to do it, though, right?
Actually, there's one way is to imagine clicking the switch. And over the years, and actually, you know, in the past year, because I've heard from so many, I mean, thousands of people who have contacted me after being on your show, I've been able to pinpoint and simplify ways that people can access this part of their brain and click their amygdala switch. And surprisingly, discussion of the amygdala has been appearing in popular press. It's been in Newsweek. It's been in Time.
I know.
I've seen the New York Times had a big article on the amygdala, and it's becoming a hot topic in brain science.
For good reason, because here is an experiment, folks. You can try, and honest to God, it works. Now, I've had a million surprised, shocked people who have sent me faxes and emails and said, "Oh my God, Art, I tried it and it worked." We'll go through the process of telling you how to click this forward, and then you can go into a sort of state of intense thought, and you can actually blow away a cloud or blow a hole in a cloud. You can do that with your brain, and that's the truth, because I've had so many people tell me it's true. Tell people how they would try this.
What I found is it's very helpful for people to identify what their amygdala is and how to identify that sensation or where it is in the brain. The very simplest way is by using your nose, to tell you the truth. Okay? The reason is that the olfactory nerves from the nose go directly to the amygdala.
They do?
Yes.
Okay. So then,
you can use smell to begin to put yourself in touch with this switch.
Smell.
And what I would suggest is you get two things. One, the first thing, now the amygdala switch can click backward into your reptile brain or forward into your frontal lobes.
And you want it to go forward.
You want it to go forward. When it's clicked backwards, then you turn off all of your higher thinking abilities, you turn off all your paranormal abilities, you turn off all your creative, intelligent, higher capacities that your brain has.
In a lot of ways, you're no better than the caveman.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so you concentrate on, I say imagining, but understanding that that switch is there, and it is a mental process itself to click it forward, correct?
Yes, you can do that. If the amygdala is located 1 inch inside each temple, you have an amygdala click switch for the right hemisphere of your brain. And
to listen to, collect, and take on the go with you. As a Streamlink member, you also get access to a whole library of Art Bell Classic Somewhere in Time shows, available as streamed broadcasts. Plus, our fun live chat sessions, held twice a month. There's never been a better time to join Streamlink. Visit coasttocoastam.com today to sign up on our secure servers. Here's what you missed on Coast to Coast AM with George Norrie.
Do you think we'll get the bottom line answer to Roswell? Is anybody ever going to come forward and just solve this for us?
My answer is no. The government is not ever, ever, ever going to come clean on this case.
And we can't emphasize enough that this even exceeds the Oval Office. The idea that there are secret keepers and we don't elect them. We have no control over them, but yet they're controlling us. And to me, that's frightening.
Now, we take you back to the night of May 18th, 1999, on Art Bell, Somewhere in Time.
Up on my website, just scroll down to the guest area to Neil Slade's name, and you know you're going to see a link that takes you directly to his website, a picture of Mike the Headless Chicken. Now, when I say Mike doesn't have a head, Mike actually has less than a head. I mean, it's horrible. It's like there's an indentation where...
After Dark is the official magazine of Coast to Coast AM. Yes, it's a color magazine delivered to your mailbox every month. And this month, read all about the magical powers of the human body. Have you ever picked up an object and had a sudden impression of a place you've never been before? Or simply touched something and felt a strange sensation of something else? If so, you're experiencing psychometry, where everyday objects offer portals to other dimensions of information. Or maybe you shook hands with somebody and felt a surge of information about that person. Or someone from the opposite sex affects you in ways that nobody else does. In that case, you're experiencing orgone energy. You can read all about that, too, in the March issue of the After Dark magazine. Subscribe now by calling our new toll-free number at 1-888-261-6392. That's 1-888-261-6392. It's $39.95 for 12 monthly issues. You can also go online at coasttocoastam.com.
Here's some exciting news for Coast to Coast fans. If you're already a Streamlink member, you know what a super value our subscriber service is. For around 15 cents a day, you get such great features as podcast. That's automatic downloads of Coast to Coast shows directly onto your computer desktop or MP3 player. But now, we've greatly expanded our full show library, so you have access to multi-year downloads. Imagine having hundreds of your favorite...
Listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring a replay of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
Question is, how would you know if Mike loved you? Mike the Headless Chicken. Hey, listen, everybody. We've got a photograph. If you go to my website right now, you scroll down to the name Neil Slade, you can click on a photograph and you will see a very graphic picture of Mike the Headless Chicken that lived 4.5 years.
Years.
4.5 years without a head.
Yes.
Please explain how that could...
Well, I think this, you know, we've all heard that saying, we only use 10% of our brain, right? So I guess that goes for chickens as well, and what they did is they cut off the 90%, but left the 10% that the chicken normally, I guess, uses. Because what's fascinating about it, now they said...
I got a million questions. Number one, why wouldn't Mike have bled to death?
I don't know. You know, you can beats me. I don't know that particular aspect of the story. Apparently
clotted up or something.
It clotted up.
This is so gory. And Mike was fed through the opening in his neck.
Yes, with an eyedropper.
Ah.
What had happened was, you know, he beheaded the chicken, and he tried to leave, like you said, most of the neck on, because his mother-in-law liked the neck. Now, I'm certainly not suggesting people try this with their chicken.
Well, I mean,
because they tried to do it again
and didn't do it,
and they were not successful. So there was a certain freakiness about this. But in any case, when the scientists. He went to Los Angeles, he went to New York, and he went to Atlantic City, and he took it to scientists in the, I believe it was Salt Lake City right away.
Yeah.
Because Frida, I'm not quite sure the pronunciation, that's on the western slope of Colorado.
Right.
So he took it to the university in Utah, and they determined that the brainstem was still intact. Okay.
All right. Well, now, what does the brainstem do?
The brainstem is the top of the spinal cord. Okay.
But it's not the brain.
The scientists have begun to call it the reptile brain. It is the brain.
It is the brain.
It is. Oh, yes. It controls. Now, humans also have this reptilian brain or the brain stem, and it's the most inner part of the brain. Your brain is kind of like
But Mike now could no longer hear anything.
Yes.
Mike could no longer see anything.
Yes. The brain stem, or the reptile brain, houses all the instinctual behavior, all the pre-programmed old learning. It keeps your heart beating. It keeps your lungs breathing.
Right.
We've told this joke again, but it's a good joke. The brain stem, or the reptile brain, controls the four F's of behavior: feeding, fighting, fleeing, and reproduction. Okay?
Yeah.
That's the reptile brain.
So in other words, Mike...
No, that was all intact. Mike, that was not chopped off.
So in other words, Mike could still, for a chicken, get horny.
Yes, and he did think he the farmer reported that Mike would since Mike was a rooster, he would try to crow, but since he no longer had the vocal, the beak to make the crowing noise,
yeah,
the sort of gurgling would came out.
Gurgle.
He would attempt to tuck what would have been his head under his feather, under his wing at night. He would still march around the hen house, preening for the other hens hens. So he went through all the programmed chicken behavior.
What about anger now, or fighting? In other words, chickens in a coop fight, don't they sometimes?
Yes.
He was taken
out of the coop to put on show, so I don't know that he had
much of an opportunity to fight with other chickens
after a while there.
Well, did he show any apparent anger over the person who had lopped his head off?
Apparently not. I don't know what he might have done had he gotten angry. But that's, the fight or flight types of behaviors are also stored in the reptilian brain.
So that was very much all of those functions then that you're describing are in the stem of the brain.
Yes.
And of course, there have been people also, have there not, Have there been people who have lived with a disconnection? In other words, nothing much more than the stem.
Yes, there's many, many cases of this. There's a terrible disease, hydroencephalitis, in which the ventricles. This is inside your brain. You have small cavities that are filled with cerebral spinal fluid,
right,
deep inside the brain.
Right.
And normally these are very small. If a person has this disease, the ventricles enlarge and the cavities enlarge, and this fluid is very acidic, so it begins to eat away the inside of the brain, kind of from the inside out. And there have been many cases in which they've been able to determine by surgery after the person died, but more importantly, while the person was alive, by taking not X-rays, but the PET scans or the MRI scans, in which you can actually look inside the cranium. And people have been left with nothing more than 1/6 of an inch outer layer of the outermost layer of the brain, and the rest of the brain has been dissolved.
When you first told me about this, I didn't believe it, and I joked about it. I said, I call them STEM people, and I shouldn't have joked about it because, as usual, it turns out it was true. I just flat didn't believe it, that you couldn't live without your brain.
Yes, you can go to the library and you can find good photographic evidence of this. People, and they maintain their IQ up until death. Now, eventually...
Wait. What do you mean they maintain their IQ?
I've often said that, and it's a very popular folk saying that we only use 10% or less of our brain. That we're only using a very small percentage of our brain.
Or need a very small percentage.
In the case of the chicken, this was pretty evident. The chicken went on doing all its chicken things with most of its brain taken away.
And they really did not notice any specific be, obviously there would have to be some behavioral changes. In other words, Mike could no longer eat and peck about as a chicken.
Oh, he went through the motions of pecking.
What?
He went through the motions of pecking. He did all the regular chicken stuff.
Oh, man.
Because chicken intelligence, you know, all of this, I don't know if there's any higher chicken intelligence, but...
Well, there must be. I mean, what's the rest of the chicken brain for? Simply to process hearing?
It's the same question we ask ourselves. If we're only using 1% of our brain, what's the rest of our brain for? And these people who have this disease in which just the very, very smallest outer part of their cerebrum is left, and these people continue living completely normal lives, we have to ask ourselves, well, wait a minute. What is the rest of that brain for?
That's where you come in.
Yeah. Well, there's another good example of that. There's a surgery in very severe cases of epilepsy. They perform a surgery these days called hemispherectomy, and this is where they completely remove one entire hemisphere of the brain. And this...
We have left and right, right?
Our brain is divided.
So in other words, they take half the brain out.
They take half the brain out because the problem in the epileptic seizures has to do with this. I'm not totally clear on what causes epilepsy, but they know if they take half of one of the hemispheres away, it keeps the seizures from happening.
Wow.
And I recall listening to a fellow who went to medical school and became a doctor after he had his hemispherectomy.
Huh.
And the half of the brain that was left in his skull took over all the functions that the missing half used to do.
All right. Since we have now proven this with Mike, the headless, how long did he live again?
4.5 years.
Four and a half years without a head. Since we've proven that with the macabre but true story, when we come back, we'll talk about what that other part of our brain is for. I'm Art Bell, and with me tonight in the first hour is Neil Slade. By the way, National Brain Awareness Week was March 16th through the 22nd. Did you miss it? Or did you not even give it a second thought? I'm Art Bell. This is Coast to Coast AM.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time, on Premier Radio Networks. Tonight, an encore presentation of Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
Living Mike. Time and Life magazines featured the bird in photo essays, and Mike's life after head is greatly detailed in local newspapers. It all began in the small western Colorado town of Ferida, I think it is, where the Chamber of Commerce is to hold or did hold a celebration Sunday to honor Mike with a 5K run like a headless chicken and other chicken-based events. Guests will have a chance to play chicken bingo, in which numbers are chosen by where chicken droppings fall on a numbered grid. Oh, God. And, of course, a chicken lunch, where senior citizens, of course, will serve anything from egg salad to chicken nuggets. It is the first Mike the Headless Chicken Day in Ferida, but probably not the last. Said a spokesman, we're trying to promote it as not that he was a freak, but that he overcame extreme adversity. headlessly challenged. Indeed, the amazed experts could not reproduce Olson's freak feat. The University of Utah and students submitted a similar fowl to a test and proceeded to behead it in a pattern similar to Mike, but the chick succumbed. Mike eventually, of course, died too, but it was not the lack of a head that killed him. It was his favorite food. You see, the chicken's manager, while touring the bird in California, sent for whole grain corn to include in Mike's diet, which was administered, brace yourself, via an eyedropper and tweezers through a small opening on the top of his exposed neck. It seems a corn kernel was apparently too much for Mike's altered intake to handle, and he choked to death on it. But not before he lived the life of a celebrity. We wanted to celebrate this little guy because he was very determined to live, again said the spokesman. So Mike the chicken lived a long time without a head. Now, that's got to be impossible, but it really did happen. That really is a true story. Neil Slade is a researcher, a brain researcher, I guess. Well, let's ask Neil what he really is. Neil, how would I properly issue some sort of short bio to the people? Are you a brain researcher?
I can't quite make that claim. Now, I was associated and I worked with a honest-to-goodness brain and behavior researcher, T.D. Lingo, for 11 years.
Right.
And I spent my time at what he fondly called the Dormant Brain Research and Development Laboratory. Now, Lingo was a Ph.D. in behavioral science, and he ran a lab for 35 years in Colorado. And so I worked with him and helped him out for the last 11 years of that.
So you studied with a genuine brain researcher?
Studied with him, helped him with his projects.
Okay.
And of course, you know, I've taught music and art and creativity in the public schools and privately for about 25 years. So I have a conglomeration of experience.
All right.
In teaching and learning.
All right. You and I have had many, many talks on the air about the nature of our brains. And it is your position that one can literally mentally click a switch forward and do things they could not otherwise do, punch a hole in a cloud that might be above you.
Oh, you can. You know, it's funny that you mentioned that, because I guess last year we started that out. Oh, it must have been about a year ago.
Yeah, and it blew a lot of people away.
We were trying to show people that it was very simple to dissolve complete clouds, not just punch a hole in a cloud.
Well, punching a hole is a good first shot,
yeah.
And then from there moving on. But you're absolutely, and then we did all the weather experiments with my audience.
Weather modification that seemed to work out.
Yeah, they scared the hell out of me.
By the way, I wanted to mention, people were on us actually, you know, it's hard to believe this chicken story, but
well, that's
people go to my website, they can see an actual photograph of Mike the Wonder Chicken.
Now let's come back down to ground for a second here. Neil, how could anything survive, particularly long-term? We've all heard stories of, you know, the chicken gets the head cut off and it goes running around the barnyard for a few minutes and then it's dead, right?
Yeah.
But Mike lived. He lived remaining senses and strutted back into the barnyard to join his friends with heads. The farmer soon found out what was once a common everyday rooster is now suddenly an attraction to the news media and curious scientists who really would like to know how any living thing could survive without a head. University of Utah scientists examined the bird, and they concluded that it kept functioning without a head because the farmer's chop left the brain stem intact. Now, I know this leaves many questions, right? Soon, the farmer named the chicken Mike and hooked him up with a manager who paired the bird with a two-headed calf on the sideshow circuit with the added attraction of Mike's head preserved in a jar of alcohol. So Mike was...
This month in the After Dark magazine, read all about the magical powers of the human body, including psychometry, where everyday objects offer portals to other dimensions of information, or orgone energy. Maybe you shook hands with somebody and felt a surge of information about that person. It's all in the March issue of After Dark. Subscribe now by calling toll-free the new number, 1-888-261-6392. That's 1-888-261-6392. 1-888-261-6392.
Now, we take you back to the night of May 18th, 1999, on Art Bell, Somewhere in Time.
Next hour, we're going to have Stuart Best here. Stuart Best is going to be talking about a pole shift and earth changes and a lot more. You're not going to want to miss that. You've never heard Stuart Best. All right, listen to this. It's from UPI, United Press International. It says, top this. In 1945, Colorado farmer L.A. Olson chopped off the head of a rooster, being careful to leave most of the bird's neck attached to the body so as to satisfy his mother-in-law's craving for her favorite fried chicken neck. It was a clean cut, maybe too clean. The chicken momentarily flopped around the chopping block, but
welcome to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time. Tonight featuring Coast to Coast AM from May 18th, 1999.
From the high desert and the great American Southwest, I bid you all.